I want to talk about the theological message of the chapter, because remember what I'm shooting for based on our first lecture is I want to take the text, we want to observe, okay, we want to read the text as observantly as we can, we want to clear out any confusion that's in our minds, come to a better understanding of what's happening, then we want to turn this into theology, theological statements that can get, then give us application, and that's the process. You're preparing a sermon, doing your devotions, it's the same process. You go through that process, okay? So, right here, a couple of things to mention. Number one, Yahweh, Israel's God, is the true God, and all others are fake. Okay, they're all a farce besides the true God. Think about this, okay? The Chaldeans earlier are saying, nobody can understand this information but the gods, and they don't dwell with flesh. Nebuchadnezzar later confesses, truly your God is God of gods, right? And of course, we know that where the Babylonians could not produce an interpretation or information, God could, and God did, okay? So that's part of the thing. When you get to the end of chapter 2, that the Babylonians should be embarrassed of their gods because they could not deliver. Second thing, God is the source of all wisdom. I mean, I mentioned that earlier, but anybody who has wisdom or knowledge or understanding, it came from God. And Daniel, wow, very wise, very able, very capable to interpret this vision. Well, the chapter says it's only because God granted him that. Okay, and so any wisdom that anybody has had to come from God. Yes?
I thought when he had mentioned his, like, in humility to the king there, he says, I'm like just any other man, I'm wise as any other man. So,
yep.
Like when he came to, when he came to Babylon, I don't think it was necessarily like his own ability to be wise.
Exactly.
I think even God was working there in his wisdom, mm-hmm. even at that time.
Yep. I mean, it's actually explicit in the text. In every, pardon me, let's see.
Sorry.
Later on, it's right here in the text, it's going to say God gave Daniel gracious favor. God gave them knowledge and understanding. See? I mean, it's explicit that it was God that granted them all this, that they would understand this. It's listed right there in chapter 1. And of course, definitely in chapter 2 as well. That's why he's saying, God's the one who gives wisdom to the wise. So, good, yeah. I mean, it's not like they showed up in Babylon with a great, lots of understanding themselves. Anybody that has any wisdom, it came from God, which is, we're saying God is the source of all wisdom. Right? Good. Third point, Daniel received blessing in life. Pardon me, Daniel received blessing, and life was sustained. In other words, these sorcerers and magicians, the only reason they're alive at the end of the story is because Daniel's humble dependence on God, that he's able to go before God and ask for God's help. And his humility is evident all the way through the chapter. He's really not doing the Arioch thing here, okay? He's very much acknowledging that he needs God's help. And finally, Daniel was granted immense honor and influence even among the pagans because of his relationship with this God. Last thing, God is the Lord of history with all knowledge and all power. That's the wisdom and might thing I was talking about. All the empires of the earth are merely temporary before him. Okay, so, I mean, here we have these four empires. These guys, they're just short term because the kingdom of God's going to roll right over all that. Over every bit of it. And of course, we could take any of these 5 points and bring this into personal application on our lives. I think it's helpful in the modern context for us to just recognize, we look around us and we see the nations that we belong to, we see all the nations of the earth and all the power that's there, all the things that are going on planet Earth. This is just temporary stuff. This stuff's going to be forgotten. The wheels of history will grind on, and all the realities that we think we see that seem so big and so effective and so powerful, it's all going to be swept into the dustbin of history. It's just a matter of time. So, interesting to think of the one reality that stands, which is the kingdom of God, God's great purposes rolling in and crushing everything else. Okay, any questions or thoughts, comments you want to make, or additions to these 5 things that we've just derived theologically from the passage?
What happened to Jehoiakim in history? Do we know anything that happened to him?
We do, and I've forgotten it. Let's see if I have a note here about it. You know what? maybe I'll run that down tonight. I remember looking at, you know, chasing it down and what happened with him, and I've just forgotten it.
That's not the king who got overthrown, his eyes got gouged out and chased down, right? Like his kids were killed?
Yeah, I mean, I don't remember myself whether that was him or the other.
I don't think that was him, that was another one.
I don't want to say because I don't. Yeah, I just don't. Oh.
Yeah, because like I'm reading about that. Like,
were you?
Right now, yeah.
Great.
So, like, I'm sure it wasn't him.
He's 25 years old. Jehoiakim became a servant for 3 years. He turned and rebelled. So, and let's see. When he turned and rebelled.
So, are you reading the right or the left?
This side. Can't read the right that fast. So, yeah. Actually, it looks like there's not a lot of information there, but maybe we can find some information. I'll write it down, and maybe tomorrow I can tell you, you know, whatever information we do have on it. So,
good question.
Yes, ma'am.
What program are you using?
That's called Accordance. It's just a Bible program. It's for the Mac. Anyway, I find it helpful, but it's kind of, yeah, it's just, it would be like kind of a professional type Bible program, but it works well. So, all right, good. Let's keep on going so we can hopefully get through all these chapters today. Chapter 2, I pointed out that it ends, Daniel remained at the court of the king. Okay? The reason I mention that, and the reason I believe that the text mentions that, is because of the next chapter. All right? We just had a dream. Nebuchadnezzar just had a dream. He had a dream of this image. He got the interpretation of the image. One of the most significant points of the image or the interpretation was, you, O Nebuchadnezzar, are the head of gold. Okay? And so Nebuchadnezzar's got to feel pretty good about that in some way. Having read that, then, next section, next chapter, Nebuchadnezzar the king made an image of gold. Okay? I think that's just too, some people say, oh, it's just coincidental. No, I think that's too significant that it didn't. I don't think that just happened. Okay, and of course, the idea then would be Nebuchadnezzar had the dream. Woohoo! I'm the image of gold. I'll go make one and just remind everybody who I am. You know, we'll put it up there. It'll be impressive. They'll be so impressed with who I am. Most likely, it was gold plated, just because something this big it probably wasn't solid gold. The height, yes.
Is there a time difference between chapter 2? Chapter 3, like, is there a significant, like, 10 years?
We don't
years?
Know. There's no way, we can't know. I will say it happens before chapter 4. This gets a little complicated here as far as the chronology goes. But in chapter 4, we have some chronology there because we know when Nebuchadnezzar died. We know that after he finished, chapter 4 is where he lives like an animal.
Yeah.
After he finished living like an animal, God restored his kingdom. So we're going to say for him to have his kingdom restored maybe a year or 2 years. And then he lived as an animal for 7 years.
Yeah.
And then it was a year before that because the pep text says that God warned him and then waited for a year. Okay, so we put all that together about 9 years from the time he died.
Mm-hmm.
And when we run that backwards, then we can say that chapter 3 has to have happened sometime. Let me go up here. Chapter 3 had to happen sometime, you know, let's say in the 580s somewhere, okay? That's the earliest it could have happened. And it couldn't have happened any time earlier, or that's the latest it couldn't happen. It couldn't happen any time earlier than 603, 602, because that's when the dream happened, okay? So in between those, we have about a 20-year time span. It could have happened anywhere in there.
Right.
But I'm still to contend, and that's why I put it 600, 599. I'm going to contend that it's within a year or two of when he had the dream. Because I don't really see him waiting for 15 years and then, oh, one day, I think I'll build an image. Okay, I'm suggesting that probably he turned around and went out and built an image pretty soon after. Probably building an image this big takes some time, right? So, you know, maybe they were working on that project for 6 months or a year. We don't really know. I just told you everything we could possibly know about the chronology. So there is no time marker in chapter 3.
I'm sure that idol, that huge thing, is probably in the, like, the time of the history. That's probably something that they wrote down, you know, in history. A big, huge idol,
yeah,
or image like that.
Yeah,
if they did,
90
feet high.
Oh yeah, 900.
No. How wide was it again?
Yeah, let me get to that in a second.
Okay.
As far as
really
history, nobody's found any kind of record.
Oh, okay.
And if there is a record, they would have found it. So, I mean, you know, there's people that live their lives searching for stuff like this.
I just, I don't know, I've read, gone through these chapters, two times already, just
mm-hmm.
going from two to three, and it just seems like, okay, there's something missing here. You know what I mean? Like, there's almost, a jump, going from worshiping God to making an idol.
Well, he doesn't know that idolatry is against Yahweh, though, exactly, right?
He sees that he is the God of gods, and then
I think you're maybe overstating this a little bit, okay? So, he's saying God is God of gods and Lord of kings, and those are both titles that are stated of Marduk, the Babylonian god. But it doesn't really say that Nebuchadnezzar came to the conclusion that that there are no other gods, okay? And in their mindset, a polytheistic mindset, well, cool, I've just met a really powerful God. I'm so impressed. Okay, I'll add him to my list. Okay, that would be one thing.
And not only that, but this great God made me king.
Yeah, right.
I'm special.
Yeah, and that kind of takes us in a second direction, which is to say, even the nation of Israel, who had just seen the Exodus, God leading them across the Red Sea, what do they do a little down the road? Okay, they go out and they make the golden calf, and Aaron says to them, "This is your God, O Israel, that has led you out of the land of Egypt," and they all worship it. Okay?
Yeah, they didn't think they were exactly doing something wrong in ways.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that I'd go that far, but you know, we'll say that the human heart has such a propensity to depravity, we can even take something good and within just not very long at all turn it into something really messed up. And we can even call it worship.
This character is probably so, you know, how do you say, in and out. With I'm gonna kill you, or I'm gonna exalt you to the Chaldeans. I'm gonna rip you up in shreds, or so he's.
Yep.
I'm gonna worship you, then I'm gonna exalt myself.
Yeah, and I'm gonna say that Nebuchadnezzar, you know, maybe he even thought, okay, this has something to do with me, maybe worshiping that god, or you know, I mean, who knows to what extent that he's viewing it this way? We just don't know. We don't know what's happening in his mind.
Okay.
So. Yeah, but I'm going to say, chapter 2, don't overthink this and think he's a believer now. I really don't think he's a believer yet at all. Well, I know he's not, because chapter 3. So, right, I mean, it's obviously something went wrong. Okay, good. Good questions. Good thought and discussion there. The height, 60 cubits, about 90 feet. The breadth, 6 cubits, which is about 9-10 feet. Okay? So, when you put that together, this is interesting. This is a weird-looking statue.
Yeah.
Think about it. This is not if normal human dimensions are not a 1/10 width against, you know, 10 times the height. That's a weird human. So probably, well, there's two possibilities. One, it could be more like an obelisk, or, you know, kind of like a totem pole idea. A phallus.
How they used to love that. Yeah.
Right. It could be something along that line. Or... what we may be talking about, one writer gives the idea that the height may have included a base as much as 30 or 40 feet high. And so once you do that, then the 60 feet, 10 feet, that works. Okay, that makes sense as human dimensions. And the base probably would have been included as part of the height. Actually, who knows? But there's an archaeologist that found what he thinks is the base. It's some kind of big, significant, huge base. And it's down in the area where the plain of Ura might have been. So is there a pot? Who knows? No idea. But that archaeologist really thinks he's found it. So, I don't think you need to make too much of that stuff, but it's interesting. Okay.
Is that, 90 by?
90 feet by, about 9 feet. I put it in meters here, 27.5 by about 2.75 wide. So, yeah, about 27 meters by almost 3 meters wide. He raised it on the plain of Dura. We don't actually know where that is. Probably, though, it's one. This archaeologist, and Miller agrees with this, came up with a place about 16 miles south of Babylon. It's probably far enough from Babylon that it's not considered Babylon. In other words, it says on the plain of Dura. It doesn't say in the city of Babylon. So it's far enough away that it probably required some kind of journey to go out there. And I say that now to tie back to this thing I mentioned up here. Daniel remained at the court of the king. Okay. One of the issues in chapter 3 is, where's Daniel in this? because these Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego refused to bow down. So did Daniel bow down? Well, the Bible channel that the History Channel, Bible series that the History Channel put out, they did this and they said that Daniel was there and he was saying to the guys, don't bow down, don't bow down. And the guys were like, no, we're not going to bow down. So Daniel was like a compromiser. Okay, they got it all wrong, messed it all up. Because the passage says nothing about that, and every indication of the book would be opposite to that. Probably the best understanding here is that everybody else has gone down to the plain of Dura to worship this image, and somebody's got to run the government, right? So Daniel, being in charge of the province of Babylon, remains back at the court of the king to take care of things. And I think chapter 42, verse 49 is a clue to that. Daniel remained at the court of the king. Okay, next chapter. Nebuchadnezzar, the king, made an image of gold. So he makes this image, he creates it, he sets it up. Then he's sent to gather the satraps, prefects, governors, counselors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the officials of the provinces. Just so you know, that was a pain to translate. Because these are all words that we don't normally use, so you had to look up everyone one at a time. And the reason I say that is so that you'll feel sorry for me. But also, because not just so you'll feel sorry for me, I want you to see that it happened there, and it happened again here, a second time, okay? And that's there because I'm confident the text wants you to pay attention to this list. Why repeat a big old list like that twice? And the answer is, well, you want to recognize anybody who's anybody is here. I mean, you want to name offices? We got satraps, prefects, governors, counselors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and officials. They're all there, okay? Everybody is here. Nobody really gets left out. And they're all supposed to come to the dedication of the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had raised. I won't comment about it, but just notice I put this in green, this phrase, which Nebuchadnezzar the king had raised. So they're all called for the dedication of the, okay, this is familiar, the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had raised. And they all stood before the image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had raised. This phrase is getting repeated. And the herald proclaimed loudly and said, you have been commanded, O peoples, nations, and languages. Okay, doesn't that feel like everybody's here? All the nations and languages. Come when the music plays, and he lists the orchestra with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 6 types of instruments. When they play, you all have to bow down and worship before the golden image which Nebuchadnezzar has raised. It just got mentioned again. That phrase keeps on coming up. Whoever does not fall down will be immediately cast in the midst of a burning fiery furnace. If that sounds arbitrary to you, it makes sense that if they built this image, they had to fire the bricks. And while they're firing the bricks, doing their construction, I mean, the ancient equivalent of like having a concrete mixer sitting there, you don't build anything unless you have a kiln there to fire the bricks. Well, what do you know? We just finished building it. What are we going to do with this kiln now? Hey, we'll use this as a threat. Okay, it's sitting right there. These kilns were built into a hillside, typically, in order to kind of hold the heat in. And people have actually gone out and done this. They've actually built these since then and tested them out and see how they work. But it would be kind of, from what we can tell, and they found them, it would look like this. And this is the hillside, so maybe the hillside is like this going down. And there would be some kind of doorway down here on the bottom level. And then, of course, there's the top. I made that look real big. That's probably no good. It's probably, like, that big or something. At the top, there's an opening. And the idea would be you stoke the fuel in here, and you lower down metal or bricks that you're going to fire or something that you want to, if you want to smelt metal, you lower it down inside from the top. Okay, so there's two different openings. These things could get really hot. Like, no joke, 1,000 degrees Celsius, 1,200 Fahrenheit, really, really, really high temperatures that they could get in these. Yes, ma'am?
Did you find out when you're studying how they would get it so hot? How would they measure 7 times?
Yeah, let me come to the 7 times thing in just a second. As far as how they get it so hot, it's just a matter of if you have something insulated like that, the dirt holding it in, it's just held in there, and even the airflow is limited somewhat, and you put in the right combination of fuels and stuff like that. I mean, yeah. And ancient peoples could do incredible things. Forget that sometimes and think they're stupid. Incredible accomplishments. Well, the pyramids, just incredible things that they did. So, yeah, this kind of stuff went on. As far as the 7 times hotter, you're right. It's not like they had a thermostat or they had a thermometer that they could lower down inside there to measure it. So I don't know that we have to look at seven times hotter and think of it as, you know, okay, someone sat down, did the math, and said, we're going to go to this many degrees. The idea is, let's just take this thing as hot as it ever possibly can go, right? And the seven times hotter would just be to say, I mean, yeah, from the, they're just taking this any way they possibly can to heat it up. So, yeah.
Is there any significance that they said seven, not like symbolically, but I've heard that, that in an ancient way, and especially with Judaism, it's kind of like the ultimate number?
Oh, yeah.
How can I put it?
Joyce Baldwin says that. She's a commentator, and so you got at least one commentator that agrees with you.
Okay.
So.
Like Peter, seven times do I forgive him?
Yeah.
Because it's a lot.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
a big number.
Right.
Okay. Okay, whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be cast in the midst of this fiery furnace. So, when they heard the sound of the orchestra, list all the instruments again, all the... This is familiar, we hear this again. Peoples, nations, and languages, that's the second time that's come up too. Falling down, worship, they all worship the golden image, which, that's come up too, which Nebuchadnezzar the king had raised. Okay, I'm saying these each time because I'm going somewhere with all three of these expressions. There's a point. Because of all this, at this time, certain Chaldeans came forward and maliciously accused the Jews. The verb, actually, in other forms, it means to eat. And basically, they're devouring. It's like, we're going to chew you up and spit you out kind of feel of the verb, okay? They're really just trying to destroy the Jews, maliciously accuse the Jews. And they spoke and said to the king, O king, live forever. Number one, let's review your decree, right? I mean, he already knows the decree, but they want to just say it again. You, O king, have made a decree that every man who hears the sound of, list all the instruments, all the orchestra, must fall down and worship the golden image, right? Yeah, I made that decree. And whoever does not fall down and worship will be cast into the burning fiery furnace. Right? Right. I made that decree. Okay. There are certain Jews. You remember what I said a little bit ago? The exiles of Judah? Okay. Why identify them by their ethnicity? Okay, these people have names, and they're going to name them in just a second. But identifying them by their ethnicity. There are certain Jews, right? Foreigners is the feel of it. And these Chaldeans, that's also an ethnicity. Okay, so there's no there's you know some real possibility here that the Chaldeans, defined by their ethnicity in power, are not so happy about these Jews working their way into power. What's up with this? I thought the Chaldeans were the ones in charge around here. Now we got Jews in the kingdom. There are certain Jews whom you appointed over the affairs of the province of Babylon. I regard that as kind of a little bit of a knife in the back, even towards Nebuchadnezzar. I mean, you appointed them, all right? Normally, the Chaldeans run the kingdom. You went out and appointed some Jews. Way to go, man. Okay? Look at what they've done now. Because now they have really, they've stuck it to you. Now they are dishonoring you. Okay? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, these men, O king, and these guys are going to make it a personal thing. They do not acknowledge you, O king. They do not serve your gods, and they do not worship the golden image, which you have raised. This is why I kept on highlighting that phrase all the way through. What's going on here? The image which Nebuchadnezzar the king had set up. The image which you have raised. What's going on here is that the equation happens, if you won't worship or honor my image, that shows that you are dishonoring me. Okay, it's associated with me. It's the one that I set up. I set it up. You won't bow down to the image I set up, therefore you're dishonoring me. So, we actually are going to see this a little bit further. Nebuchadnezzar, in raging fury, commanded that they be brought. They brought these men before the king. He said, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you're not serving my gods, you're not worshiping the golden image, which I have raised? I did it. You're not paying attention to that? Now, if you're ready, when at what time you hear the sound of the... Now he's going to list all these instruments of the orchestra again. Fall down and worship the image, which I have made... This is about me and my work. Then, well, this is kind of an elliptical Hebrew construction. If you're ready, the King James says, well, this is fine. But if not, if you will not worship it, you will immediately be thrown into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. I'm going to regard this right here as basically Nebuchadnezzar giving them a second chance. Okay, he's saying to them, it's already happened. They already played the instruments. Everybody was supposed to bow down. These guys didn't bow down. That would have been a very public thing, right? I mean, in front of everybody, in front of the whole crowd, they stood up. So everybody knows about it. So it's a, kind of at this point about the king's honor, right? Because if he is not willing, if they're not willing to do this in front of all those people, then maybe all those people are going to dishonor the king or think the king lightly of the king because he let them get away with it. So I'll give you another chance and I'll bring the orchestra back out. Okay? I mentioned the thing about the instruments, and I think the instruments are listed here. I mean, why? It's like the fourth time to list horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, bagpipe, and all kinds of music. Why would mention that every time? And I think basically the idea is this is a whole orchestra. You got a whole bunch of instruments. Let's face it, to get all those instruments together and ready to go, it's a little bit of doing, right? It's a little bit of work involved with it. And the king's saying, I'll give you a second chance and we'll call the orchestra back. Okay? Bring the orchestra back in and they'll play again, and then you guys can have a chance to fall down and worship. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego said to the king, we don't need to return an answer to you concerning this matter. We don't even need, basically the king says, I'll give you a second chance. And they say, we don't need a second chance. We don't need a second chance because we already know what we're going to do. Okay? So tell the orchestra to go home. Okay? Call the guys who fire up the kiln, but you can tell the orchestra to go home. Because they don't need to play because we're not even going to try. And as this is developing, what's happened here is that this has developed now not just into a contest between Nebuchadnezzar and the men. This has turned into a contest between Nebuchadnezzar and God. Okay, because verse 15, look at Nebuchadnezzar's words. I'm going to throw you in a burning fiery furnace, and who is the God who will deliver you out of my hand? Okay, there is not a God in heaven or in earth that can possibly deliver you from me, because I'm King Nebuchadnezzar. Right? Don't trust in your God. A couple things I have to mention here. Number one, nobody's brought up theology so far. I mean, nobody said, even even up here earlier, these Chaldeans, when they talked to them, they never said anything about these guys, they're trusting in their God. They never said anything about their God. They did say that they don't worship Nebuchadnezzar's gods, but they never said anything about them trusting in their God. And it makes me think, why is Nebuchadnezzar going to say this to him? Who is the God who would deliver you from my hand? I suggest that Nebuchadnezzar already has encountered these guys enough to realize that their faith in their God is very strong. And so he's thinking, I bet they think their God will deliver them. So just so you know, no God can deliver you out of my hand. You're going in. Okay? And therefore, it's a challenge. Their answer, we're not going to give you an answer, we don't need to think about it. If it be so, and that what that means is, if you're going to do this way, if you're going to think this way, if you feel like you need to throw us in the fiery furnace, okay. Our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and from your hand, O king, and he will deliver. Our God can. Okay, you say, who is the God? We say, our God. Who is the God that will deliver you out of my hand? My God will deliver you out of me out of your hand. Mm-hmm. But even if not, okay, this is a little awkward wording, I think, for us as we come to it in English. But the idea is, even if not, certainly doesn't refer to even if he's not able. So as you put the grammar together, it has to refer to whether he will choose to deliver or not. Mm-hmm. And the idea is, even if our God chooses not to deliver us, even if he chooses not to deliver us, we know that, number one, he can. And we know, number two, that we will not serve your gods and we will not worship the golden image which you have set up. We're not doing it. We're absolutely not moving on this point. So the challenge has been struck. Who's going to win? Right? Who wins the challenge? Nebuchadnezzar was filled with fury, and his facial expression was altered toward Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. This is why I'm saying up here that he's giving them a second chance, because even though he was angry with them, he's already, they're important, you know, men in his kingdom. He'd rather not kill them if he can manage it. Okay, I'll give you another chance. And now his facial expression is completely altered. Now he's not even in the give them a second chance mood. And so he commanded them to heat the furnace 7 times more than it was usually heated. In other words, as hot as possible. And to the men, mighty men of strength in his army, he told those men, bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, cast them into the burning fiery furnace. Okay, that detail that they're the strongest men is recorded here because those strong men, the strongest men Nebuchadnezzar had, when they picked them up, that they weren't even able really to get to the front, to the mouth of the furnace without themselves being injured and actually killed. Okay, so they're injured just trying to get the guys there. But Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego get thrown in. Interesting, a couple of things to point out here, right? And he said to bind Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Then these men were bound in all their clothes, and they were thrown in. These men who took them threw them in. These three men fell down in the midst of the fire, having been bound. Third time now it said something about being bound. Okay, so they're probably tied up hands and feet, and they're thrown down into the fire. Nebuchadnezzar was astonished. He rose in dismay. He looked down and he said, "Didn't we cast in three men having been bound?" That's the fourth time we've heard this. Well, I see four men having been unbound. How did that happen? We tied them up. Now they're not tied up. In fact, they're walking in the midst of the fire. In fact, they're not even hurt by the fire. How'd that happen? And most important of all, there's this change here. We threw in three men. I see four men. And the fourth is different. He's similar to a son of the gods. Okay? There's a possibility that would be an angel. Most interpreters have suggested, and I would agree with this, this is probably an appearance of the pre-incarnate Christ, that they're walking in the midst of the fire with Christ. And either way, I mean, the message is that God does send help even in the midst of the fire. But how much richer that the idea that walking in the midst of a trial or in the midst of the fire, God himself is with us in the person of his Son. That the same Jesus who himself suffered on planet Earth, he's in the fire with us in the midst of that trial, walking with us. We're still in the fire, right? We're still in the trial, but he's still there with us.
Mm-hmm.
Nebuchadnezzar goes up to the burning fiery furnace, and he answering said, "Servants of the Most High God, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, come out and come here." And I pointed out Sunday that there's kind of an irony in here, because basically for him to say, "Come out and come here," it's because that's the only way he can get them out. He already lost his best men trying to get them in. Okay, so he can't send, it's not, okay, I'll send somebody in after them and pull them out. How do you do that? They're in the fire. They're the only people that can survive in that fire, right? I mean, it's so hot at this point, you know, 1,000 degrees. You think like, well, maybe you could get a hook and put it, the hook would melt, right? I mean, that's the heat, mm-hmm. kind of heat we're talking about. You're going to melt a hook trying to pull them out. You can't get them out. The only way they come out is if they want to come out willingly, if they say, "Sure, we'll walk out." And now this, you know, powerful king who says, "No God can deliver you out of my hand," is reduced to, "Please come out," right? Because otherwise, how am I going to get you to come? "Please come on out. Please come out, come out and come here." Then they came out from the midst of the fire. Okay, you've got to notice this now, because I made a point about it up here before. Remember all these names that were so hard to translate, and it got repeated again in the next verse? Everybody who's anybody is there, all peoples, nations, and languages, peoples, nations, and languages. Okay, the passage has emphasized it. All the big wigs, all the big names are there. Guess what? They gathered together, the satraps, prefects, governors, and king's counselors, and they were all there, and they all saw that the fire had no power over the bodies of these men. They all witnessed it firsthand themselves. Earlier, verse 21, the passage had specifically recorded, these men were bound in their tunics, their trousers, their hats, and their other clothing. Okay, they were fully clothed. And now down here, what we discover is that their cloaks were not damaged. Fully clothed, and all their clothes are fine. In fact, their clothes don't even smell bad as a result of the fire. They're just doing fine. The only thing that got damaged in the fire were the cords that they used to tie them up, right? Because these guys were walking around unbound instead of tied up. That's it. Everything else is fine. Nebuchadnezzar answered and said, "Blessed be the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who sent his messenger and delivered his servants who trusted on him and set aside the king's command. This is kind of a shocking statement. What he's saying is, blessed be this God and blessed be these people who did not listen to me. They're blessed because they didn't obey me. Verse 28, and they set aside the king's command. And they were not willing to serve or worship any god except their god. So I make a decree that every person, nation, and language that speaks something against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego shall be made into limbs. That's the way I translate it. Turn them into a pile of limbs. And his house will be made a public bathroom, because there is not another god who is able to deliver like this. then the king caused Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to succeed in the province of Babylon. One of the men in the class earlier today just said, it kind of seems random, doesn't it? Earlier in the story, if you won't bow down to my image, it's you know, you're toast. We're going to burn you. Just kidding. If you say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, which I just blasphemed only 15 verses ago, then you're in big trouble. Okay. And, you know, it's like, okay, people are allowed to grow and learn and repent and convert and such. But give you know, a little bit of time here, man, don't you think? And in fact, chapter 4, the next chapter, we're going to see Nebuchadnezzar still has some learning that he needs to do. Okay, but he's growing. He's making some progress. I mean, this confession is better than the last confession, right? The last confession was pretty, you know, it was okay. And then chapter 3, not looking so good. Okay, now he's doing a little better. He made a little baby step. And actually, when we finish up the fourth chapter, I'm just going to point out that these chapters, when they're put together, they testify the fact that God is really gracious, and he puts up with a lot, and he works with people to draw them to himself. Okay, so it's little by little he's drawing in Nebuchadnezzar the pagan. And by the end of chapter 4, Nebuchadnezzar is going to confess, and it's going to be a real, real good confession by the time we get to end of chapter 4. So, one other point to make, and then I'll look at some of the theological points, theological values. Okay, we've seen chapter 1. Chapter 1, what we saw in that first chapter was that these men came in, and they were raw refugees. Okay, they were nobody. 14-year-old boys in a kingdom where nobody knows their name. By the end of chapter 1, they've gone from being nobody refugees in a kingdom where nobody knows them, and they've gotten exalted, and now the king has talked to them. The king has heard of their name. Actually, the king's impressed. They're 10 times better than anybody else. But that takes us to chapter 2, because in chapter 2, you have this dream thing that goes on. And all the wise men come, and the wise men can't interpret the dream, and Daniel can't interpret the dream. And by the end of the chapter, Daniel is given a high position in the province of Babylon, and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they're all given positions in the province of Babylon. So you had a major promotion at the end of chapter 2. Okay? And now we're at chapter 3. Chapter 3, it looks like these guys are going to get killed because they're not willing to bow down to the king's idol, to his image that he set up. And so they are actually thrown into the fiery furnace to be executed. And instead of them dying, they come out. And at the end of chapter 3, what do you know? God has exalted them again. They've gotten another promotion. Okay? Now follow me with this, because I'm not going a direction to say God's people always get the promotions. Okay? We all recognize God's people don't always get the promotions. There is a theological point to be made way off when we get to chapter 12, okay, that some of this is going to go towards. But the book itself, and it's not a thing I'm making up, that's why I want to point it out, the book itself is leading you to notice this. Hey, these guys, they just keep on going up every chapter, don't they? They just keep on getting a promotion. And the only reason that happens is because God intervenes and allows them to be blessed and promoted in the province of Babylon. Okay, theological points to be made from that chapter and what we just saw. Number one, loyalty to God above any human authority or the pressures that a human authority can exert will sometimes result in exaltation even with them. In other words, there's sometimes when your boss says, hey, I want you to cheat a little bit on this one. And you say no. And your boss fires you. Okay? There's other times when your boss says, I want you to cheat on this one. And you say no. I don't do stuff like that. And your boss thinks to himself, you know what, even though I'm dishonest, even though I like it when people help me be dishonest, there's something to that guy, right? There's something to that guy. And sometimes it's exactly that fiber and character that actually God uses to bless his people.
Pastor where, David can testify to that. Sorry.
What's that? No, go ahead.
Pastor David at Lighthouse, that's the exact story of what happened with his employer. And his employer wanted him to do something bad, and he said no, and then he got promoted because he was trusted, and then they built a stronger relationship, and he blessed his family with the word, and it really paid off for him.
I actually know a businessman in South Carolina, very high power businessman, and it was a situation soon after he got the job where a guy came to him and asked him to do something like that, and he responded the right way. And it turned out later that was actually a test, like the guy was actually checking him out to see where his character was.
Courageous.
We did that. Yeah. Courageous.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Okay. I didn't remember that. So loyalty to God, sometimes they will result in exaltation, even if sometimes it doesn't, but sometimes it does. We must exercise faith and show our ultimate loyalty to God's expectations, even when the outcome is unknown. Basically, we'd want to reach a point where we would say, even if God allows me to suffer, I'm still going to do what's right. Even if I suffer for my faith, I'm going to do what's right, because I'd rather have done what's right and suffer for it than do what's wrong and be rewarded and later on suffer for it, right? So I'm ultimately going to be loyal to my God. I think Daniel chapter 3 is one of the key passages for Christians understanding what you do when you're put in a situation where, you know, either you do what's wrong or you're in big trouble. Okay, you know, the government said to a Christian, do this, reject Christ, or fill in the blank XYZ. Daniel 3 gives us some answers about what we should do in those situations. And final thing, our faithfulness to God before unbelievers presents a testimony that will push them towards the truth. Okay, same idea. Sometimes unbelievers externally will look at us, mock us, reject what we're doing, and so forth. But inside, they're thinking, you know what, I kind of wish my life was like that. One of the things that's going on right now in all across industrialized nations is, of course, the pressure of rethinking homosexual marriage. And so that's going to be a broad pressure for Christians, just all across the board. Well, I read an article here recently that was great. The guy basically said, yeah, we're going to get persecuted on this. We're going to get marginalized. We're going to get made fun of. But guess what? Okay, if you're a person who has a good marriage and you're raising your children for the Lord and you love your wife, that's just going to get increasingly really rare and start looking kind of weird out there. And people are going to look at that and say, how does this work? You know, I mean, what if they walked into a church and they saw an entire church full of people who love their wives and raise their families for the Lord? They got to think, there's something different about these people, right? And so while we're saddened by what's happening in across the world and in our nations, we can also say, well, let's take this and use this as an opportunity for the gospel.
It will magnify God's grace,
right?
No matter what.
Yeah. Yeah, people realize the only way that could happen is if God did something. Yeah. So that's all I have on chapter 3. Any comments real quick? And if we can manage it, I'd like to just keep on going and finish out chapter 4, and then we can be done for the night. That would be my personal preference, if we can do it. If you want to stop and get something, that's great. We just get a drink or pick something up or whatever. Any comments on chapter 3?
I just think it's really neat how God shows himself to other people. It's very neat. You don't see that very often in scripture.
Right. Yeah.
Paid in person and given such an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, a lot of the Old Testament characters, I have often thought of their integrity and their character and their humility.
Mm-hmm.
But really, when you think about it, none of them really compare to Daniel.
Mm.
I mean, he's just such character, and it just keeps building. It keeps getting better, as we go through the book.
It's really good.
Yeah. And still so young.
Yeah.
Can you get out of hymn books and sing Dare to Be a Daniel?
I find it interesting when they're walking in the fire and the Lord's with them.
Yeah.
That they're still in the fire and still walking, and it seems to be taking a while for them to do the walking. And they're probably still walking while Nebuchadnezzar asks them to come out.
Uh-huh.
But the idea of them being there, just walking, they're not running around in mud.
Yeah.
You know, and they're not collapsed in a heap somewhere, which would indicate that they were damaged, or could imply that they were damaged. The fact that they just kept walking until someone asked them to come out just strikes me somehow.